changed our greeting away from hugs and handshakes to shrugs and fist bumps or whatever else goes on, and not for the sake of not saying we love each other or not committing each other, but you don't know who might be helped by not passing something. And it maybe your precious mother or grandmother or something like that. So it's worth it to love one another for a little while in that way. With that said, it was called for a National Day of Prayer. And I'm going to be honest with you, I don't care who calls for a National Day of Prayer. Praise God, amen? Because what is prayer? Have the doctors fixed this yet? Have the bureaucrats fixed this yet? Have the insurance companies fixed this yet? Has Wall Street fixed this yet?
Nope.
Now, in fact, as they come up against this, they appear more broken, each and every one of them, don't they? Who is bigger than life? God, because He created life. Who's bigger than viruses? God is. I'm not diminishing what viruses can do. I'm not getting at that at all. But who should we turn to? Who gave doctors the abilities to learn all those books that they have to learn before they can get that little degree? Big degree, I guess. Right? He did. And so what prayer is, it's turning to God. Amen? And for a nation to turn to God, that's big stuff. And for, I said, if we all come get together and say, you know, it'd be nice if the nation just turned to God. Well, we got a National Day of Prayer. As a church, what should we do?
Right.
There's an idea. Not just talk about it, but actually do the prayer. And God's got some things in His Bible about that. He's going to respond. Now, let me ask you this, church. What does our nation deserve? One more time. What does our nation, as a nation, as a nation, to glorify God, what does it deserve? Have we turned more to God than the last 20 years or are further away? So what do we deserve? That's why grace is so amazing. We're still under grace, aren't we? In undeserved favor from our God. And when we get that, we learn to be appreciative. Instead of shaking our fists at God, we bow our heads to God. Wow, what an amazingly patient and loving God. He puts up with me in spite of me. Right? And because of that, we can go to Him at a time like this. I read just a little bit, and I'm going to run through these verses just really quick and just give a little backdrop. Jesus, God in the flesh, God in a body like you and I have got, God in a body that craved the things that you and I crave, God in a body that wanted to lash out at others and all those other kind of things, and yet, through the power of God Almighty and His Spirit, He said no to every bit of that so He could be a worthy substitute for you and me as He took our punishment through death, right? So here He is on earth, and life hadn't been easy. By the way, it's not easy on earth. God didn't promise you that as a Christian. It says, now as soon as they come out of the synagogue, so this must be of a Sabbath, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. But Simon's wife's mother, that'd be his mother-in-law, y'all heard of those? Lay sick with a fever. And they told him about her at once. And he came and took her by the hand, lifted her up, and immediately the fever left her, and she began serving others. What would it be great if God lifted us from where we used to be and we just immediately began serving others? Probably a whole sermon there, but we're not stopping there. At evening, when the sun had set, they brought to him all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed. And the whole city was gathered at his door. So they've been through a Sabbath day. He gets home, there's work to do there, ministerial work, right? Did it stop? No, it was just getting going. Right? And have you noticed that when you care about somebody and you minister to them, have you ever gone to a funeral? Someone that you cared about deeply, or you went to somebody who lost somebody that they cared about deeply, and you spent that time loving them. Usually, a funeral, time is all said and done, sometimes 3 or 4 hours. You get there a little early to visit and grieve with them through the service and go to the graveyard with them and get home. How are you when you get home? Are you refreshed? Wiped out. Emotionally wiped out. And ministry often does that. When you love somebody and you bear their burdens and all that, it does it. Jesus had been doing that. And coming right up against the battle of Satan as He delivered those who were demon-possessed. And the whole city was getting at His door. Fix this, fix that, fix this, fix that. I will be honest with you, as a pastor, I can't fix everything. I just point to the one who can. And sometimes he doesn't fix them, he guides us through. Sometimes he takes us home. And some people don't want that issue from somebody. No, I want it fixed. Don't give me those other options. Just I'll fix it. And they'll hold you accountable as a Christian. Why didn't you fix that? I thought your guy could do anything. He can and he will do it perfectly. Amen? But people often don't want that news that not now. Not your way. Even though God's word will always turn out to be more loving. That's been a million years. You and I will agree that everything he did was loving. Everything he allowed gave us opportunities to glorify him even more. Then he healed many of those who were sick with various diseases, cast out many demons, and he didn't allow the demons to speak because they knew him. He wouldn't let them announce who he was yet. Now, after an exhausting day of loving people who wondered if he was able to deliver everything, but just, do you think that they were loving Jesus or loving what he could do? You know, in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he did what? Pray. How was he replenished? By sleeping late the next day? When did he get up? Early. And where did he go to get replenished? Alone with God. Alone with the Father. Now, he in the flesh, if God in the flesh could be replenished by having that time with God, pray, how much more important is it to those of us who aren't Jesus?
Yeah.
Amen? If he being the perfect example of what a man could be, did this, well, just going to a meeting and passing the hat and doing this kind of stuff, is it the same as time with God before he's thrown? And you can be on your knees. You can be standing. You can be sitting playing the guitar. You can do all that kind of stuff. But you've got that time with God. And he calls for that individual time. But he also calls for the corporate time. All of us together. Forsake not the gathering together. And so today what I want us to do is look at the importance of prayer. Now I want us to pray together. Not just talk about it, but do it with one another. A little different service, but I want us to have this hour where we're actually not just listening to some guy talk, but talking with God. And so as we go through this, we're going to talk about some of that. So let's pray and we'll get started. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for your perfect example. Thank you that you're there, that you're available, that you're not exhausted. All of your resources are still right there. Thank you, Father, for such a time as this to know, Lord, that you're there and you're asking us to pray. Lord, your word says, it gives us those conditions there that if we come to you, Lord, there's healing available. And Father, we don't know what kind of healing, but we know it's perfect. We know the kind of healing you want to offer is eternal and not just a temporary fix. And yet, Father, you can do all things and will do all things and you'll do it the most loving way. So I pray today, Father, that we leave here refreshed from having been with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, years ago I put that little song together, and I'll tell you, I wrote it, but who wrote that? The Holy Spirit wrote that part, and I had three or four of the verses. Two or three of them done went away. But that first one stuck, because sometimes I want to control things. Right? And when I find myself sitting on what should be God's throne, I stand in judgment. I stand how this ought to happen, all that kind of stuff. And it's time for me to kneel down. And as a nation, I think it's time for us to kneel down. We've pushed it a long way, haven't we? They're very worried about the deaths caused by this coronavirus, but many more unborn will be killed tomorrow.
Right.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Many more are going to pass away from lack of care. Many more are going to pass away from neglect. Many more are going to pass away without knowing Jesus. And so it's interesting where we put our priorities. And everyone is affected by this virus. I am not diminishing one little bit. But as a nation, I think it's time that we bow down. So I'm appreciative of a national day of prayer. So if my people, who is he God speaking? Anybody in here called on the name of Jesus to be your Lord and Savior? Then that's us, right? Called by my name. How many of you love the name Christian? It doesn't scare you. It's who you are now.
Yes.
It's not what you do. It's who you are because the Holy Spirit's residing in you. So if my people called by my name will humble themselves, not sit there in judgment of everybody. That's not our place. Right? But it doesn't say if you get everybody else speaks. It says if my people will do what? Come to me. Right? Will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Not hiding from God. Not playing games with God. But God, I don't want anything between us. Just you and me, face to face, so to speak. Turn from their wicked ways. What are wicked ways? Anything away from God. I'm not talking about religious stuff. I'm talking about stuff that we do that doesn't honor God. Right? It's very different. Well, I've got this religious artifact and that one, and I've done my religious chores today. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about genuinely seeking His face in ways that honor and glorify Him. Turn from our wicked ways. God says, then I'll hear from heaven. And if you heard that song, it kind of increased the speed because God's excited to hear from His kids from heaven. Amen? He wants to bless His kids, and I'm not talking about the money and the this and that. I'm talking about He wants His kids to have His best. How many of us don't want our kids to have the best that we can give? And you know what? There's some of our kids that can't handle it right now, and I think that's how God looks at me. They're like, give me my best, but you couldn't handle it. And I couldn't. I wouldn't know what to do. It might give me the big head. It might distract me from what God would have me to do and all that. So His best is what He limits to me to keep me focused on Him. And you know what? When I recognize that He is giving me His best in so many ways for my benefit. Because He loves me. And He loves you. I'll hear from heaven. Forgive their sin. Praise God. God's not mad at you. Right? If He wasn't so mad at you that He kept you from being saved, then He's not mad at you now that you are saved. I disappoint Him way too often. But at the same time, He still wants the best for me. And He wants to live through me. He wants other people to come to know Him. He wants to have eternal rewards. Can you imagine, importantly, what's your eternal reward? Maybe a person that came to know Jesus. Somebody you witnessed to, somebody else led them years later. It may be that. And can you imagine how you look at that person together and you say, remember that day? Well, what a reward. That person's not in hell. That person's in heaven. Because remember that day? Remember how you loved them even when they weren't acting lovely? Remember how you loved them even when you felt bad? You remember those days? Think of what God wants you to have. Forgive their sin and finally heal their land. Does our land need healing? It absolutely needs healing. So, how do we pray? Who do we talk to? Jesus told us, didn't He? Who did He say to talk to? In this manner, therefore, pray. He says who? Our Father. So who do we go to? Our Father on the throne. Right? Now we know we serve one God. Amen? Jesus showed what God would look like as a man because He was a man and He's the fullness of God. He let us know that the Holy Spirit is with us always, but He said the Father's there. And what did He do? He tore down that veil between us and the Father, didn't He? We can only go to the Father but through the authority of what Jesus gave. I don't know if y'all remember when Columbus discovered America. Any of y'all want to know? But in the name of the king or queen, he come in and say, in the name of the king, I established this as part of the Spain, I think it was at the time. Right? You know what? In the name of Jesus, I get to come to the throne. Amen? Not magic words, but by the authority vested in me, invested in you as a Christian. Because of what Jesus did, I get to come to the throne of God's grace. What a high privilege that we have. And what does He say? Your kingdom come. In other words, whose will do we want to happen? Your kingdom come. Who's running this world now? Do you know? The Bible says the prince of the power of the air. Who is that? Satan's got a lot of power. God allows it. Why does God allow it? Give you a choice. Amen? You want the goodies that he promises right now, or you want God's best for eternity? And he gives a clear choice, doesn't he?
Amen.
Okay. Who's in the wife's wedding? Whose fault is that? If it looks like Satan's winning, whose fault is that? Because he has a team on the field right now, doesn't he? Does God have a team on the field right now? So if Satan's team looks like he's winning, maybe God's team's not playing. Does that make sense? When we go out from here, do we say, we are the champions, and you can join our team? Or do we go out and say, somehow God's going to get me through this? Do we look like champions? Do we live like champions? I don't mean haughty. I don't mean big-headed. I mean knowing who we are, whose we are, and what we have to do while we're here. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is. Listen, it is that way in heaven. When we get to heaven, this won't be going on. Amen? Give us this day our daily bread. And in this case, maybe toilet paper.
Yeah.
I'll have a couple of y'all up anyway. I used to teach about communism, and they would show the empty supermarkets in Russia, you know, way back in the 80s or 90s when I was teaching that. And now you go to Walmart, and in the back row, empty places there. But who's going to provide for us? You know, God is going to provide for us. Do we know that? How many of you has he dropped so far? He's still there. Isn't he? You may be in a horrible storm. Some of you are, I know. But he hadn't dropped you. Who do you go to get through that time? And he's given you enough to get through that next day, hasn't he? I know that because he's done that with me before. Different situation. Don't want to even compare woes. But at the same time, God has never, never turned loose. In fact, he said, I will never leave or forsake who?
Yes.
You. Right? How many of you are you? Just called you all you. You must be a you. And he said he would never leave or forsake who? You. And so you don't know it. You don't feel it right now, but God's got this because he's with you. Forgive us our debts as we forgive others. The world doesn't know about forgiveness because sometimes God's team don't show them. They don't know what it looks like. It makes no sense to them. Why would I forgive somebody who hurt me? How many of y'all know people still waiting for justice?
Yeah.
Don't happen on this earth. Really, what we like on this earth is vengeance. They hurt me, I want to hurt them. You know, that kind of stuff that happens. God's got the ultimate justice, right? And how are they going to know what it looks like, this forgiveness, if they don't see it? And I'm not talking about conditional forgiveness. I'm talking about wanting the best for somebody and helping them achieve them in a godly way. No longer let what they did hold it against them. It doesn't mean that I'm going to trust a car thief with my car. I need it, right? But it means that I don't have to hold them angry. Car thief want to ride? I'll drive you. Amen? I'll love you that way. That kind of stuff. Okay, responsible forgiveness. And do not lead us into temptation. Is it okay to tell God, I'm weak? Please don't put me in a spot where I'm going to fail again. How many of us get tired of failing God? Help me with that, please, God. Is it okay to tell him that? It's a sincere heart, isn't it? If we mean it. Now, it's not this way. God, you don't want to fail again, so would you fix that for me? Treating God like a flunky is not kind of not smart, is it? Deliver us from the evil one. It's okay to tell God, God, he's really good at tempting me, and I fall for it so many times. Would you help me? Would you help me? And I don't know how God's going to help you. He may zap it right now, but he may what? Allow the treatment to take effect. Sometimes the treatment takes a while. Patience is part of the fruit of the Spirit. And for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. What I want us to do for the remainder of our time together is pray. But I want to do it in a certain way. I want to have topics. I want to have times that we talk about what's going on. Before I do, I want to look at another verse. Who can pray? One of the scariest things that I did as a new Christian, I'm sorry, I wasn't a new Christian, I should have been much earlier in my life. But I saved at 14, didn't start growing up in it until I was about 30. was to pray out loud, scare me to death, they're going to call on me one day. So I'm not going to call on anybody I don't want to be called on. Okay, just get that out of your head. But I was afraid of it because what if I did it wrong? Anybody have that problem, scared? What if I pray wrong? What if somebody misunderstands? What if God misunderstands? What if I ask God for something that's wrong? And all the things that come up, what will people think about me? Listen what the Bible says. Likewise, the Spirit, that's capital S, that's the Holy Spirit, that's God, also helps us in our weakness. What stops us from praying in front of others? How will the rest of the world learn how to pray if they don't hear the church pray, if they don't hear God's team pray? It's okay to talk to God. Amen? And so, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we should pray for as we ought. This is Paul talking, the guy that never seemed to run out of words. Right? And way higher words than I can come up with. But we don't know what we should pray for and how we should pray as we ought. But the Spirit, God, the Spirit Himself, makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. God takes your prayer, edits it, fixes it, and presents it in such a passionate way that we couldn't even imagine the language that is presented perfectly before God. So let me say it this way, it's foolproof. You can't mess it up. Somebody come after church and said, you know, I heard what you said, that didn't sound right, this and that. Said, don't worry, it was delivered perfectly. Amen? It was delivered perfectly. They said that President Johnson was having breakfast in the cabinet one time and had called on one of them to pray. And the guy knelt his head and he mumbled. And at the end, somebody heard him say amen. Said, President Johnson said, I didn't hear a word you said. And that secretary said, it's okay, I wasn't talking to you. It's not about how well you speechify. Amen? Not about how many these and nines and thous. It's about what? Communicating with God. Turning to God. And so, He, the Spirit, who searches the hearts, knows what the mind of the Spirit is because He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. What will God do with your prayer? He'll match it to His will. What will you get in results? God's perfect will. You're not going to make God do something He don't want to do. Right? We don't change God's mind through prayer. He often changes ours. He changes circumstances. He heals nations according to Scripture. Amen? And so what we're going to do is we're going to turn the camera off. And we're going to have a couple microphones stationed around. And I'm going to call out some topics. And if God's laid it on your heart to lift up a few words about that topic to Him, we're going to be bound with you, praying where we are for the same topic and allow you to lead. Who is you? They used to say, whoever's knuckles are the whitest on the one in front of the... Don't worry about that. If God lays it on your heart, there's nobody in this room that God loves more than you. Did you know that? There is nobody. And so, we're going to have a time of prayer. So, let's go to the Lord and do that. We have the camera turned on.